Welcome to another show of Celebrate Life. My name is Gary DeCarlis, and I'm your host. The focus of this series is to show the amazing lives people live. The key word here is live. Everyone has a story to tell, and all stories are worth telling. Over the years, I've read too many obituaries that left me pondering, why did I not have a chance to meet this person while they were alive? Well, the goal of this show is to celebrate the lives of everyday Vermonters who are all very much alive. If you would like to be interviewed or know someone who would like to be interviewed, send me an email at celebratelife0747@gmail.com. Now, I would like to introduce Issouf Ouattara. Hello, Issouf. Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
So I know you have an amazing story to tell, and I'm going to just let you start where you would like to start, and we'll go from there. I know you're from West Africa.
Yes.
Why don't you take it?
Yeah. Yes, I'm Issouf Ouattara. I live in Colchester, Vermont, and I've been at UVM working for almost 13 years now. And I relocated in U.S. in Vermont because that was my first real destination in the U.S. In 2010.
Issouf, I want to ask you about that. Yeah. Now you were in what country? Burkina.
Burkina Faso. Burkina
right.
Faso is in West Africa.
Right.
Yeah.
So you made a choice to leave the country, obviously, and hopefully we'll talk about that
sure.
more.
Yeah.
Why America? Why the United States?
America, because we'll probably get to this because of English first. You know, because Burkina Faso is a French-speaking country.
Yep.
And as such, you know, the world is what it is today, a big village, global village, we call it. And in the career field that I was, English was kind of becoming such a burden that I decided to do something about it, about myself. And but the American dream was something that I had even very young. I was thinking about it, and but there was no way I could imagine that that can come true someday, coming to the U.S.
When you thought of the United States when you were a little kid and you thought, geez, it would be great to be there someday, what about America really captured your imagination?
It's so. I think the image itself and what we hear, we hear great things about America. You feel like America is the best place in the world, and from the movies, from what we hear people talking, it's kind of a place where everybody wants to be, because you know, they think life is would be great there, and like all the things that we see in the movie, and that can trigger a lot of dreams.
Okay, kind of the land of opportunity, as we
yes.
would say. Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, but as a young boy, you don't think really opportunities. You just see the picture. You just draw some pictures in your mind, and you think like this is the best place to be.
Mm. Yeah. Mm. Well, thanks for saying that. I'm always curious when someone chooses a country. They have
right.
What about that you know really captures their imagination?
Right. Right.
Well, take us back to that being that little boy, and what was life like in Burkina?
Life started like a normal kid living in. I was born in Ivory Coast.
Okay.
Ivory Coast. We share borders with. Few countries, among which we have Ivory Coast, so that's where I was born.
Okay.
But my father's country of origin is Burkina Faso.
Okay.
So life was normal until the age of 12.
Hmm. Okay.
So the age of 12, the country was starting to get into some political crisis, and school was becoming very hard to attend.
Mm.
And I'm the first child of my parents, And my father didn't want me to lose a school year.
Right.
So he decided that, you know, I'll go to his country of origin to pursue my studies.
Okay, so you went back to the Ivory Coast?
No, I went to Burkina Faso this
time. Oh,
you
went back to, okay.
Because
from
we
the
were
Ivory
living
Coast.
In
yes.
Ivory Coast
yeah,
where
yeah, yeah.
I was born.
Okay,
yes.
Gotcha. All right. Huh, and when, before we, before things got tough, and you said life was normal, what was normal for you as a little boy?
Normal kid with toys and going to school and playing with friends. Nothing so special, I would say.
Was it an urban life, rural life?
It was mixed.
Okay.
You know, it was mixed because my father was, you know, working in the agricultural field, and so we would travel and. You know, from the, you know, towns and cities to the farms and stuff like that. That's the kind of environment where I grew up.
Did you have extended family nearby?
No.
Okay. No. Right. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. It was a nuclear family.
Okay. And then the, and you have brothers and sisters?
Yes, I do. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
How many?
I have... 8 brothers and 2 sisters,
nice.
And now 1 brother passed away.
Okay. And are they still over?
They're all in Burkina Faso.
They're all in Burkina
nowadays.
Faso.
Yes.
Okay.
Yep.
All right. So life was fine. You were enjoying life.
Yes.
And then the political turmoil started when you were around 12 years old.
Yes. And I had to leave my family. It was painful for a 12 years old boy. Yeah.
And then, and so, then you went to, you were in Burkina Faso, and
yes.
you went to, well, you went back to Burkina Faso.
I was in, you we were living in Ivory Coast.
Ivory Coast, and then you went,
and
yes,
then I went
I'm
to Burkina Faso to pursue my studies. It was mainly for studies, and that's where my parents brought me to a Catholic boarding school where I was living in school and studying.
Okay.
There. Yeah.
How was that?
It was tough. Catholic boarding school was, you know, for the young boy that I was at the time, it was hard to live. And but quickly I adjusted because, you know, started the training, started the education and all that, and I had very good teachers and trainers, and I quickly adjusted and I. Faced the reality.
Wow, yeah. You, yes. So you were missing home, obviously.
Every day.
Every day.
Yes.
And it's a whole new environment.
Very new.
New country.
Country and, very new culture, I would say.
Yeah.
You know, because my parents are Muslim.
Mm-hmm.
But
you're in a Catholic school.
And then I find myself in a Catholic school.
Wow.
You know, when I was growing up, I learned everything about Islam and
yes.
all that. But in Catholic boarding school, I was among the few people that were different.
Right.
You know, but later on, I'll change. But I wasn't practicing then.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I started practicing the Catholic religion very later on. I was even after I was in college when I got my baptism.
Okay, so you literally you chose to change religions being in that school.
No.
No.
I didn't change
okay.
because I wasn't feeling it.
Yes.
But I lived in the culture.
Yeah, right.
Right.
Okay.
For many years.
Wow.
Yeah.
So you finished high school there?
Yes, high school there and went to college. College was different, of course,
mm-hmm.
But I stayed in the Catholic boarding school for 8 years.
Wow, that's a lot of time.
Yeah.
So you were a young man when you came out of there.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. When I was leaving the Catholic boarding school, I think I was around 17, yeah, 19,
yeah.
sort of, yeah.
Yeah.
yeah. 19, 20, around.
Yep.
Yeah.
Did you have any So you were taking, my question is, were there people in your life early on that influenced you?
Yeah, my father, my mother, yeah, of course.
Okay.
They were kind of my heroes.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, because even though my parents were living in Ivory Coast, they never stopped telling us where the origins are, where they're coming from, and, you know, yeah, we need to keep that in mind to be able to find ourselves someday, because they said if you don't know where you're coming from, it's really hard to live the present and even envision the future.
Wow, that's so, a powerful message there.
So that's something that I kept hearing throughout the years from my parents when growing up.
Wow, that's wonderful.
Yeah.
Huh. And so did they ever come to visit? Could they come to visit?
Yeah, they could.
They could.
And then I could go there, but for a very short period of time.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Okay. So you got through boarding school, and then what?
Then after the boarding school, I kind of did what I would call here middle school, high school, and then from there I went to college. I went to law school, graduated there with a Master of Business Law, and then I had to teach a little bit when I was, you know, kind of looking around for a job, and finally found myself in the banking industry as a lawyer.
Wow.
Yeah.
You were doing well.
Yes. Yeah, I was doing well, but that was me.
Yes.
Only me, and that was not enough.
Yes.
Because I had, you know, my family members also that I needed to take care of, and so, yeah.
Being the oldest son, did that come with a level of...
A lot of responsibility nowadays. Mm-hmm. It's what it is.
Mm-hmm.
Today, father is not there anymore, and everything kind of fall back on my shoulders in terms of decision making and stuff like that.
Yes.
Yeah.
How did you choose law? Where did that come from?
I chose law because I was kind of frustrated at a young age, you know, because my father was laid off from work, and then they started some law suit stuff, and, you know, the justice and, you know, going to the courts and stuff, but I found that he wasn't compensated properly.
Mm.
You know, and then I was seeing the lawyers around, and even the attorneys, and the amount of money that he was spending, and that created a lot of hardship for the family. So, and I sometimes pictured myself, I said, if I was, you know, a lawyer or an attorney, maybe I could be able to help for free, or at least I would be able to give him some advice and things like that.
Yes.
And I said, okay, that stayed. And I carried that all the way, and I said, someday, even if I don't become an attorney, I'll be able to either defend myself or give advice to people in the law field. And so
nothing like experiencing an injustice firsthand to motivate somebody to do something.
I think that's where my motivation went from.
Good for you.
Yeah, thanks.
But Burkina Faso started to have its own troubles.
Troubles, and that's where, it's true that I had a dream to go to America to study and learn English and all that. That with my own situation, if I was picturing only myself, I would say I was successful, mm-hmm. but it wasn't about me. And, you know, I had two boys already, and then I was thinking about them. I was very lucky to go to the Catholic boarding school. I learned a lot. I would say that's shaped who I am today. Mm-hmm. So thinking about my boys, I wondered sometimes if they would have the same chance or the same luck. If nothing is done. So I started I would say shopping around, trying to gather some information about a place where I could relocate to mm-hmm. give a chance that I got, or the chance that I got someday. Mm. Because to me, we always say that it would be unfortunate if a son doesn't do better than his father.
Right.
So,
right.
So, but before that, you have to give them the means. You have to, right. you know, help them first and set them up to, right. succeed.
And that was on your mind. How can I?
Yeah.
What do I need to do to make it work for
right.
them so they have
yeah.
opportunity?
Right. And then that's how I discovered a program called the Diversity Visa Program. I said, okay, can I be eligible for this? And the answer was yes.
Mm.
All I needed to do was to apply for it
mm.
and count on the odds.
Mm-hmm.
And I applied, I think, twice, and the third time was successful.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
And when that came up, now I needed to gather all the means and start, you know, preparing for my trip.
Mm-hmm.
But I couldn't come with the entire family. So what I did is I decided to go see what it would be first, and then if I think it's good, I will
bring them over,
and that's what happened. I came in, and 6 years later, they were here.
Wow, 6 years later.
Right.
And how did Burlington, Vermont happen, of all the places in the country?
Burlington, Vermont, I didn't know anybody in the U.S., not anybody who could, you know, help me stay with them or
right.
anything like that.
Right.
That came from, you know, my connections with people in Burkina Faso. You know, in the banking world, you kind of have a big book of addresses and
yes.
stuff, and
yes.
you interact with a lot of customers, and so, and sometimes you build some kind of relationship with them. And so I shared that with a friend once, and I said, this is gonna hold me back if I don't have any place to stay or any address even to insert in my folder there.
Right.
So he said, no, I have a friend in New York, and let's share this with him. Maybe he'll be able to help you out. He's been there for quite some time, and that friend said, okay, that's an opportunity, I would help you, but you cannot stay with me forever, but I'll give you a chance to be here and find a place to live on your own at some point, but I think I'll help you.
Hmm.
So, but that was still not enough for me. I kept looking,
right.
you know, and,
right.
then I heard about ALV here in Vermont. You know, ALV is the Association of African Living in Vermont.
That's right.
And then when I looked to see what this association could help me with, I discovered that the executive director is someone who went to the same law school as myself.
Okay.
But I didn't know him then, you know.
Right.
So I called him, I got his number and called him, and he said, come over. So what I did is I spent a week in New York, and I did not like it for what I was planning to achieve.
Right.
New York wasn't the place for me to stay.
Yeah, big city, big city.
It wasn't the place for me to stay or to start from. So I decided to explore again the ALV option, and a week in New York, I took the train, Amtrak, and then I was here.
Wow! And this fit better.
Yes.
This fit better.
Yes. This is really the place I was looking for to stay with my family.
Wow! Yeah. So you came over.
Yep.
Your family stayed.
Yes.
In Burkina Faso.
They stayed in Burkina Faso with my wife and the kids. They stayed there. Yeah. That was kind of a safety strategy, the safest strategy we could. I said, okay, if it doesn't work, because I was leaving my job and leaving everything behind,
right.
I said, okay, if it doesn't work at some point, I'll go back, and then at least we'll have somebody who is employed in the house. Before I get something, I said, but if it works, then we'll get this done properly.
Wow. So Issouf, you were a lawyer there.
Yes.
When you came here, could you use your law degree?
No, unfortunately, I could not. I explored the way, and now there were no chance of me, pursuing that here without going back to school and with not really a chance to go to law school. Going to law school in Burkina Faso was really hard to even get to the school. It's a very selective process. Same as here.
Yep.
And I just didn't have the time to go back through the same process again.
Right.
And the law I studied it's different. Law systems.
Sure.
So I could understand why it would be hard for me to just jump in it like this without going back. So very quickly I knew that that would be a big barrier for me. And the first barrier for me was the language, because when I was coming here, I couldn't say a word in English.
Is that right?
Oh, yeah.
You were French speaking?
Yes.
Right.
Speak French, and that's all I could
You do amazing.
Today, yes. Maybe much better than when I arrived. So, that's what happened. And then I realized that English would be the first thing to work on.
Yes, the first task.
Yes, that was it. I said, okay. If I really want to stay here, I need to take this seriously. And that's what I did. For 2 years, I kind of did only studying in English.
That's did you take classes here?
Yes.
Okay.
I did. I started with the Burlington Fletcher Free Library.
Yes.
I was taking classes there after work. And then they sent me to Sarah Holbrook,
yep.
Right. Yep. So I took some classes there, and from there I went to Colchester ALV. That's where I think after there I had a teacher who advised me to go to CCV directly, because he thought that I could be more successful at CCV already with what I had and the dedication I was showing him.
Yep.
So then I went to CCV to pursue the English classes there.
Wow, you really put your mind to do this.
This was a
big, when you get focused, I get the sense nobody's stopping you.
Oh no, because I grew up with a motto saying that the objective is better than yourself. That means that you need to, so this is a translation word by word from French to English.
Yes, right.
So I know maybe I'm losing some substance there, but you get it,
yes,
right?
Yes, yes.
So yes, that means that you need to put yourself focus, and that you'll be, you know, trade-offs, and you know, you pay for it in terms of sacrifice and all that. But the objective, you need to realize that it's better than yourself. Yeah. The objective is where, what you're there for.
Yes.
So, yeah.
The goal that you're shooting
when
for.
When you're aiming at the goal, the goal is better than yourself.
Yes.
So you need to put yourself to work.
Yes.
And that comes sometime with, you know, hardship and pains and sacrifice and all that. But if you really want to achieve the goal, that's the price for it.
Wow.
Yeah.
Sage wisdom.
Yes.
Your mom.
Yes.
So. So where did you work during that, when you first got here? What?
First got here, I wasn't, you know, in contact with ALV, of course, and with them. They helped me go to ADECO. I don't know if you do. ADECO. It's kind of a place where they will place you to, you know, organizations to work, and that's how I started. And I started with Twin Craft.
Okay.
Twin Craft is where I worked first.
Yep.
And then after that, they sent me to a brewery in Shelburne, I would call it Magic Cat.
Wow.
So I worked for a few days there. Then I went to Burlington Rehabilitation Center. And at that point, I was working with some folks and asking them how I can study, how I can pursue my studies. And people were tired of hearing me saying that. They said, okay, if you get an employment with UVM, then they have a way of, you know, handling the benefits there, where you can benefit from the tuition remission.
You take classes for free.
You know, you'll be able to study, but you have to find a way to get in there.
Right.
So, and I started working on that, I think it was in 2011, in April 2011, I applied. They were looking for temporary employees to, you know, work in the dorms when the students left. And then I got a 3-month temporary job employment there. That's how I entered.
You broke the cosmic egg, right?
Oh yeah. So then from Burlington Rehabilitation Center, I found myself at UVM. That's what I was looking for, and I had only 3 months to, you know, to stay there or to leave.
Right.
So I didn't play around that opportunity.
I
really wanted to stay, and so.
And you landed a job.
Yes. At the end, they said, "No, the way you're working, we'll keep you."
Wow.
And then they offered me a permanent job.
Wow. And you've gone far from that beginning.
Yes.
To where you are now.
Oh yes, because now that I had the opportunity to be a permanent employee, I had to explore that tuition remission benefit. So I started taking classes. I was, you know, taking classes, any classes, you know, I was just taking classes all over to practice my English. You know, that was the goal. I wasn't thinking about any major or anything like that. All my thing was being able to interact and speak English and be understood.
Wow.
You know, and that was my thing. So I was taking classes here and there. And then at some point, I couldn't take classes anymore because I had to enter a program.
Okay. Like declare a major or something
yes.
like that? Yeah, okay.
And when I got to that, you know, they have, I had an advisor at that point with continuing education. Mm-hmm. And they sent me to the grad college. I met folks there and they asked me what was my background. I shared that with them and I needed now to prove that I had a law degree. Mm. So that I did that through World Education Services. It was a tough process, but I ended up getting my credentials evaluated with the connection that World Education Services was able to have with my University of Burkina Faso.
Right.
So I got that
So you got credit
done.
For a lot of that?
Yes, I got that. I got that evaluation done.
Wow.
And they kind of recognized my credentials, not to work with them,
right.
but to study.
So
that saved me
yes,
time
yes.
and energy.
Yes. So in other words, you took a lot of classes to get that English down.
Right.
At the same time,
yeah.
your degree was recognized and the credits from that degree were
right.
applied to UVM.
Yes.
That pushed you up
to
a senior
and to go for another master.
Yeah, to go for another master.
Yes.
Wow. Okay.
Which I did, and I went for another master. In 2017, I entered the program, the MPA program, the Master of Public Administration.
Yes. Yep.
Because that had a lot of stuff, you know, very close to what I studied in law school, norms and policies and
yes.
stuff like that. I said, okay, that would be the best fit for me.
Wow.
And then I graduated in 2020.
Wow.
Yeah, from UVM.
That's amazing.
With the Master of Public Administration.
And you're still at the university working?
Yes, I'm still working, but all this time I had some, you know, experience also with the career. I started in custodial services,
mm-hmm.
like a temporary employee, like
yep.
I mentioned
yep.
earlier. And then 3 months later, I was a permanent employee. And then 2 years after that, I became a level two. And then from level two, I went to the supervisory role directly.
Right. Wow.
And senior supervisor. I stayed senior supervisor, I think, for about 6 years almost. And then I'm kind of new to my role now, and I applied to be a Kronos processor and in payroll services.
Yeah.
And that's the work that I'm doing now. I work
wow.
for payroll services and tax.
Wow. Well, congratulations.
Thank
what
you.
A.
Thank you.
My goodness.
So I'm kind of coming back to my business world.
Yes, you are. Absolutely. Do your brothers and sister have the same gusto that you have, that same focus like
they
that?
They do. They do. In the family, we have two doctors.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we have like pharmacist, doctor.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't know if the word exists.
Yep.
And then we have a medical doctor also in the family.
Wow.
And we have a lawyer also in the family. And
wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
So.
Yep. And so how did, this is a question about.
Yes.
You. So your family was still in Africa while you were here for 6 years,
yes.
right?
Yes.
What did you do to keep that connection alive and vibrant?
You wouldn't believe it, but I called every single day.
Mm. I had the feeling you might do that.
Every single day.
Good for you,
I
Dad.
I called.
Wow.
Yes, I called. Yeah.
So you kept it alive through that.
Yeah.
Yes.
Did and then I got the chance also to visit.
I was going to ask you
yes,
if you went back a few
yes.
times.
Yeah. Yeah. Once
oh.
before they came.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Because I arrived in 2010. In 2013, I paid them a visit.
Wow.
That was 3 years later.
Wow.
And then 3 years after that, they
wow.
were here.
Tell me about the day they showed up here. What was that like?
Yeah, it was, it's, I don't know how to say it, but it's kind of I don't know. I don't have a word to describe this, but it's magic. It's you know, the sense of achievement.
Yeah, right, right.
It's like that was all I was, you know, working for, and
right.
Yeah.
Oh, that's beautiful.
Yeah. I kind of forgot all the hardship. You know, when you're talking about this, it's easy, you know, to tell the story about it, but you know, in the actual moment when you are living the process,
right?
Sometimes you don't know where you're heading to.
Right, right.
Very
tough. But
you have to keep moving.
Yeah. So you mentioned, I think that your father has passed away at this
yes.
point. Your mom's still alive?
Yeah, she's still alive.
Yeah. How's she doing?
She's doing great. She's happy.
Yeah. Has she been able to come over here at all?
We are working on it.
Are you?
Hopefully, yes, I'm working on that. That's the next step for me now, the thing that I'm working on now. I hope that she will come someday, not to stay, but to visit at
yes.
least. And,
yes. Yeah. Oh, that's beautiful.
Yeah.
Okay. And how are your kids doing?
They're doing great.
Yeah.
I'm very proud of them. And you know,
tell me about
like
your
I
old
said, they are not my friends, but
yes. Tell but me about your oldest son. You had mentioned something before.
Yes,
the show
he's
started.
Graduating in few days from UVM with a bachelor in electrical engineering.
Wow.
So,
that's beautiful.
Yes.
But, congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And the other one is still in high school.
Okay.
And the very young one is just starting schooling.
Well, that's great.
At Union Memorial School, yeah.
Fantastic.
Yes, well, still in kindergarten.
So, what a life.
Yeah.
It's a story.
But I'm enjoying the journey. I think that's
good.
the good thing about it, yeah.
Yeah, okay. So, Issouf, tell me about the mentors or those special people in your life that have given you something to make you a better person.
You know, like I mentioned, I left home, my family, at the age of 12.
Right.
And you picture a 12-year-old boy on his own, it's tough.
Yeah.
So I was lucky to have, I would say, good people around me who really I would say played the role of my parents to some extent. And, you know, in the Catholic boarding school there, that's how I spent the entire time. And because my father told me, you are living, we are not there, but it will be up to you to have other fathers there or other mothers there,
mm-hmm.
but that will be up to you. It will depend on your behavior.
Mm.
So you need to behave well. When you behave well, you always find people who would like to be your parents, who would like to be your relatives. But it's all about how you behave.
Mm.
And that behavior piece, you can be very intellectually set, academically, you can be a very good student.
Yep.
But when you don't have that behavioral piece, you are missing the big piece
okay.
to lead you to
wow.
success.
Wow.
And I kept that dearly for myself, and I kind of followed the advice from my parents. And so, and when I got to Vermont here at the UVM, I got some mentors. Leslie Carnegie, those are the names that I'll be saying here. Leslie Carnegie is one of the mentors that I got. I also got for mentor Barbara Benton, also for mentor Connie Russell.
Mm.
Those are the people who I had very good interactions with them, and I was asking them good questions, and they gave me some directions and led me all the way. And I really want to be grateful for that because the mentorship is something that I can say that I'm a living testimony of what mentorship is and the product of mentorship. And I'll share with you the piece with Barbara Benton here, because when you look at my career path, starting at UVM as a temporary employee for 3 months, and then as I went to be a permanent employee, and that's when I met Barbara Benton in custodial services. I think she was in charge of training and development. I don't have the right title today, it's been a while. But we had a session with her once, and I think she was kind of sensing something that I could give. And during the staff appreciation week, she wanted me to share my story with the department, and which I did. With my, you know, English at the time, it wasn't good English, but I tried to share my thoughts and remarks with people, and people liked the story. And that story brought me so far away that I could ever imagine, because people asked, they talked about it all over campus, and I found myself at some point in front of audiences almost every day, sharing from one department to the next, the same story.
Wow.
So I became known on campus.
Yeah.
And that helped me with the adjustment and the cultural shift that I was going through. Because when you step in a place and you hear somebody who you don't work with on a daily basis saying your name, it's kind of so comforting, and it puts you in a comfortable environment to study, to work, and even to live.
Yep.
So I really want to be grateful for all the great work that the mentors did for me. And mentorship is something that I always value. And I'm trying to be a role model myself, to be a great mentor for those in need.
That's great. So it sounds like by sharing your story, you created a community around you.
Yes.
Because they got to know you, you got to know them.
Yes.
And then it changed the whole dynamic.
Yes, that's how I learned also the power of storytelling.
Absolutely.
Yeah. It's really powerful. Sometimes we have assumptions, let me say, with people, we have thoughts that are not real until we hear them out, until we hear their story.
That's right.
And then we start seeing them under another angle, or another scope, or we have another view of them, another perception. That's the word I was looking for.
Exactly.
And I think storytelling is really powerful.
Very powerful.
Yes.
Okay. Any, you know, you mentioned some of the words of wisdom your mom and dad had shared with you to help you in your own growth.
Yes.
Do you have any pearls of wisdom that you would share with the audience about life?
About life, you know, I would say that people always find something to say. You know, in terms of critics and stuff. But the most important thing is to be authentic and realize that you cannot control what people do or think. You know, the only person that you can control is yourself.
Right. Yep. That's very true.
I've been living with that.
That's a beautiful way to live life. Okay. And anything else you want to say about your life and where you are today and what you see the future looking like?
I see a bright future because I'm very optimistic. But you know, you can only aim high and then you work for it. Would you be able to get there? Sometimes it depends on many variables. But all we need to do is never give up and keep working, because in life we say that, and I grew up with this one too, and they said there is worse in life than failing,
mm-hmm.
and that worse is not trying.
Ooh, yeah.
So
take the risk.
Yes. Let's keep going and
that's beautiful.
Never give up.
That's beautiful. Have you devoted any of your time to helping new Africans coming to this country?
Yes, I do that with Champlain Housing Trust. I'm doing some volunteering work now with United Ways, and United Ways not too much nowadays, but Champlain Housing Trust, I'm a board member, Champlain Housing Trust.
Oh, yes.
And we are working on the housing stuff today. The housing crisis is a reality in Vermont. And,
exactly.
You know, I was reading some papers about one of the cities here, I don't want to say the name, it's kind of troublesome.
Mm-hmm.
But I think we need to share our stories, and it's possible. And what I would like to say here is, you know, we're coming to a new environment. It's a new culture, and what we also need to keep in mind is that we are the ones coming in a new environment,
mm-hmm.
and we shouldn't be waiting to get everything from people who are kind of hosting us, I would say.
Mm-hmm.
But we do need to do something also.
Mm-hmm.
And that's something, it's not always like in a financial side of things, but it's more like in the human piece of us that we need to keep working on, and because we are the one coming in,
right.
We need to work to be adopted instead of waiting for people to adopt us.
Oh, that's interesting.
And
yes.
I think it's, you know, what I'm underlining here is the accountability piece of that journey.
Right,
you know,
right.
It's very important.
Right.
Sometimes people will not do with you, they will not interact with you because they love you or like you. They interact with you because you are bringing something to the table.
Right, exactly. So you've got to show them you have something to offer and
right.
Sometimes,
yeah, sometimes when you call, you need a plumber, you know, you don't go and look in their lives. It's really the talent that they have that you are buying here. So it's what I can share with all the new Americans coming in. And
yes. I would think you'd be a powerful influence for the good if, in helping others.
Yeah, I'm trying to do my small piece there, but there is always room for improvement for sure.
When you went from the Ivory Coast to Burkina Faso,
yes,
did that help you prepare from coming from Burkina Faso to the United States, that
it,
change?
It did.
Yeah.
Okay. It did in terms of experience of going to landing to a new environment where you don't know anything about, that helped because I was 12 years old.
Yeah.
And, you know, and now when I was coming here, I was a bit, you know, a grown-up guy.
Yeah.
But if I said if I did it once, I can do it twice.
Right. That,
you know,
yes, okay.
Yeah. And the difference is the culture. So I'm kind of really introverted person by nature. So I take a lot reflecting, and that's where I get my my strength from. Mm-hmm. That's my own personality. I reflect a lot on my own before I voice anything out. Mm. But as you know, not to say that that's a good personality. Everybody has a personality, and there is no personality better than the other. But it's just me where I get my strength from by, you know, reflecting on my own and, you know.
That's that authenticity that you had mentioned earlier on. That's your way of gathering your strength and doing something with it.
Right.
Yeah. So. Yeah. Well, it's been a pleasure having you on the show today
and
hearing your story and celebrating your life. And there's a lot to celebrate here.
Yes.
And thank you very much for coming.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Gary.
Yeah, you're welcome.